بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم الحمد لله والصلاة والسلام على رسول الله وعلى آله وأصحابه أجمعين. We praise Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. We thank him upon all conditions. We send blessings and salutations upon Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and all his companions, his entire household. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala bless them all and bless every single one of us. My dearest brothers and listeners, indeed, we have been going through the lives of the companions of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam for 20 minutes every Wednesday. And it's important for us to be reminded once again who these people were. Because sometimes when we hear the term Sahaba of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, we tend to forget the value of these people. We need to realize when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala created creation, He first selected the best and the purest of the souls, and that was that of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. He then chose thereafter the rest of the messengers of his, and after that he chose the hearts of those who were to be his companions. May Allah's peace be upon all of them. What we say when we hear the names of any one of the companions is radiyallahu anhu, which means may Allah be pleased with them. May Allah be pleased with him if it is a female, anha, anhum if they are plural. And the reason is they worked so hard that it's a dua from us. May Allah be pleased with them. It reminds us that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala chooses whomsoever he wishes to serve his deen. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala then becomes pleased with those who do so with the correct intentions. If you look at Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, if it was anyone else besides him, they would not have stood out the way they did, the way he did sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. He endured. If we were to say someone was a messenger, say from amongst us, some would say, wow, that's an honor. You know, for example, just in case, if for the sake of thinking, if there was a Nabi, someone we knew was a Nabi, astaghfirullah, I mean, it's just to think. The point being raised is, we in our lives would think it's an honor, not realizing that it comes with great difficulty and hardship, more hardship than anyone else. This is something we need to realize. The point I'm raising is, for us to think, wow, he was the best of creation, the most noble of prophets, he must have had it all on a platter. In fact, yes, he was helped by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. He was assisted directly through revelation, but he endured and he went through that which, if it was anyone else, they would have given up. Remember this. The same applies to the companions, radiallahu anhum. If you take a look from the beginning, the family of Yasir, may Allah be pleased with them. Bilal ibn Rabah, may Allah be pleased with him, radiallahu anhu. When it comes to the likes of Khabbab ibn al-Arat, radiallahu anhu, Al-Arqam ibn Abi al-Arqam radiyallahu anhu, Abu Bakr as-Siddiq radiyallahu anhu, including Hamza ibn Abd al-Muttalib radiyallahu anhu, Mus'ab ibn Umair radiyallahu anhu. Each one of these, they suffered, they endured, they went through a lot of hardship. They gave up their lives. A lot of them were martyred in order that the deen continued in such a way that today it came to us. Wallahi, don't think that you are a Muslim, so it's okay, it's just a gift of Allah, without thinking exactly how that gift came to you. This is why Allah says, when you breathe, think about your faculty of breathing. وَفِي أَنفُسِكُمْ أَفَلَا تُبْصِرُونَ. Don't you see within yourself how Allah has created you? Don't just think, okay, I'm seeing, I can see. What about those eyes? Have you studied them? Have you looked into them? Allah speaks about the camel as well. أَفَلَا يَنظُرُونَ إِلَى الْإِبِلِ كَيْفَ خُلِقَتْ. Don't just look at the camel. Ask yourself, how was it created? Go and study it. The Quran says, look at the skies. Don't just look, but go and study. What's it all about? Look at the planets. See, every day they are discovering new planets that are bigger than the biggest they ever discovered in the past. It's something amazing. The same applies when you sit and say, I'm a Muslim. Think about, how are you a Muslim? Who worked hard so that Islam came to you and appreciated it? Remember this. If we don't appreciate, then honestly, we are from among those who perhaps do not have the sound heart. We need to rectify our heart. Let me explain to you. At the time of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, there were so many people. Not all of them were chosen to be Sahaba radiallahu anhum. Take a look at Abu Jahl. he was blessed in one way, and that was he got to see Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. That was a blessing. But he did not realize the value of that blessing because his heart was dirty. That's the reason. His heart was filthy. It was filled with jealousy. It was filled with pride. It was filled with arrogance. These are blockages from hidayah and guidance. Hidayah will only come to those who strive to earn the pleasure of Allah. Hidayah only comes to those whose hearts are ready to receive from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. You have a motor vehicle that is locked in front of you and you want to drive it to town. How on earth are you going to do that? Get the key, open the door, jump in, start the car, then you will go. It needs to be ready with its fuel and with all the other things that are needed. The tire pressure needs to be there, or there's, you know, no flat and so on. And then you will get to your destination. But if you have a closed, locked vehicle, how are you going to benefit from it? The same applies. The heart is like a vehicle. It will carry you through to Jannah on condition that in that heart you have the goodness, you have the key, you have something that will open the door so that you can start receiving things. What is that? Purity, goodness, love for others, the sense of justice in your mind, in your heart, the openness to the message of Allah. When someone fires you with a powerful reminder, instead of becoming arrogant, you actually become soft. That's the good heart. When Abu Jahl was told, "Qul la ilaha illallah," say la ilaha illallah. In fact, Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam used to say that to all the people, "Qulu ayyuhan nas, qulu la ilaha illallah tuflihu." O people, declare that there is none worthy of worship besides Allah and you will succeed. Leave these idols. What you are doing is wrong. It is absurd. You are following your forefathers. Start following Allah. Start turning back to Allah. Some people became angry. They went up to harm Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. They actually caused his blood to spill. The droplets of blood in Taif. You know what happened. Why? Weren't they honored to see him? Yes, they were, but their hearts were dirty. So they rejected it. Imagine if Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam was here today. If I were to ask you, what would you do? We would say, mashallah, honor. What a blessing. I would do this too. How do you know you would do that? Our hearts are so dirty and filthy that we'd probably ignore him. And we ignore those who hold his message. We would probably not even greet back. We probably don't want to hear from him. If he were to talk about himself and his companions and the verses of the Quran, we would walk out. We have no guarantee what we would do. So if we want to cleanse the heart, or if we want to benefit, we need to clean the heart. And if you want to clean the heart, you need to check it. You need to make sure that you are looking into that heart. Otherwise, you are not going to achieve much. Like I said, take a look at Al-Akhnas ibn Shuraiq and Abu Jahl, Abu Sufyan, just before he accepted Islam, well, years before. They used to love and enjoy the recitation of the Quran and the listening to it and its meaning. They used to go tiptoeing in the darkness of the night to listen to the words of Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, or the recitation of Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam of the words of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And they used to enjoy it thoroughly. And they used to, as they were coming back, they bumped into each other. And all three of them are leaders of Quraysh. They're not supposed to be doing that. So what happened is, one said, "What were you doing?" The other one says, "What were you doing?" The other one says, "What were you doing?" Then they confessed, "We were here to listen." "No, no, no, we can't do that. We are leaders of Quraysh." Now listen, they were greedy for what? Power. When they were greedy for power, they wanted to remain the wealthy, they wanted to remain the powerful. They had no religion in them, there was no deen in them. What did they do? Immediately, they decided, rather throw away the Quran, but keep our position. The position we hold in Quraysh, we want it. We will lose the position we have in Quraysh. We will lose the authority, the wealth, the business deals, everything. So I'd rather leave the Quran. I'd rather leave what I know is correct and right. But at least I won't lose my worldly position. When the others who were blessed to become companions whom we are speaking about this evening, what did they do? They said, "No, we'd rather follow what is right and lose the business deal. We'd rather follow the Quran and forget about what Quraysh thinks of us." Mus'ab ibn Umair, one of the wealthiest of the youngsters, he followed and he said, "I'm not really worried what will happen. His family members, his mother as well, they stopped spending on him until he became so poor. But not once did he doubt that what he was doing was right. For us, like I said, we have to think, really and truly, is our business deal more important than what is right or wrong? Than what Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam brought? If that is the case, Allah says, قُلْ إِن كَانَ آبَاؤُكُمْ وَأَبْنَاؤُكُمْ وَإِخْوَانُكُمْ وَأَزْوَاجُكُمْ وَعَشِيرَتُكُمْ وَأَمْوَالٌ اِقْتَرَفْتُمُوهَا وَتِجَارَةٌ تَخْشَوْنَ كَسَادَهَا وَمَسَاكِنُ تَرْضَوْنَهَا أَحَبَّ إِلَيْكُمْ مِنَ اللَّهِ وَرَسُولِهِ وَجِهَادٍ فِي سَبِيلِهِ فَتَرَبَّصُوا حَتَّى يَأْتِيَ اللَّهُ بِأَمْرِهِ Wallahu la yahdi al-qawm al-fasiqin. Allah says, say, O Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, tell them, if your fathers and your children and your brothers and your family members and your business deals that you are fearing to lose and everything else, a whole list of things made mention of, if all those things are more loved to you than Allah and His Rasul and struggling in the path of what is right and correct and justice, then hang on for a while. We will give you a little bit of time. Then you see what we will do to you. Our command and instruction will come. And Allah says, وَمَا أَمْرُنَا إِلَّا وَاحِدًا كَلَمْحٍ بِالْبَصَرِ Allah says, our instruction when it comes, it's one quick command, like the blink of an eye, destroyed, out, gone. We gave you a chance, we gave you time, but you preferred something over what you knew was right. From among the companions, subhanAllah, those who heard the Quran, few verses, they crumbled. From that day on, they became known as, may Allah be pleased with them, radiyallahu anhum. It was, up to today, it's an insult to say the name of Umar ibn al-Khattab, radiyallahu anhu, without saying that term, radiyallahu anhu. Why? He was not a Muslim before. He had intended to harm Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and he had harmed some others. But when he crumbled and he made tawbah and his heart was correct to receive. And what happened with that heart? It was very hard initially, very hard. It was very far. But he went up, he beat his own sister up and he saw the blood. And it is reported by Ibn Hisham that when he saw that blood, that's when he got soft. Because he says, hey, this is my sister. What am I doing? What am I doing? Something softened him. But sometimes with us, nothing softens us. We see one thing after another. We know this is punishment. We know this is a loss. We know we are struggling with this matter and that matter and health matters and whatever other matters, all in a row. But still we haven't even turned to what we know is right. Why? Because we fear. We fear. If we fear, then we belong to the same group that those who feared that time belonged. They lost. Some of them actually feared so much, they lost the deen in totality. Abu Jahl. What was he? Who was he? Umayyah ibn Khalaf. Who was he? He was an enemy of Islam outright. Abu Lahab. Who was he? An enemy of Islam. They were given a gift of being in the company of Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, but they did not realize the gift until it was too late. Sometimes we are gifted. We have so many things in our midst. We have so many reminders. We have so many beautiful opportunities, but we don't turn. We don't turn. Then where do we belong? Then we want to talk about Sahaba radiallahu anhum, companions. What was the who were these companions? Why did they become companions? How were they known as companions, Sahaba? They did something. If we want to be companions in the hereafter, we've got to follow suit. We've also got to surrender. When the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam said anything, anything, immediately without even blinking and batting an eyelid, they actually surrendered. They heard it. They followed it. They obeyed it. They obeyed it. May Allah make us strong. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala help us. So when we hear the stories of the Sahaba radiallahu anhum, these were not just heroes and heroines of today. These were the real superstars of Islam. The iman you have, the Jannah that you are going to go to, and I, inshallah, it will have come to us because of the effort of those people. Take it seriously. Take it seriously. Listen to their lives. Listen to what they went through. Try and emulate. Try and understand why, how. If we want to show appreciation, even a little bit, we need to try and emulate and follow. Try and show a bit of importance, meaning give importance to it. So, my beloved brothers, what we will notice is from among those who were fearful, some they didn't believe outright. What happened to them? They lost. How much money did Abu Jahl have? A lot. How much did Abu Lahab have? Abu Lahab had so much money that Allah says in the Quran, مَا أَغْنَى عَنْهُ مَالُهُ وَمَا كَسَبْ. Allah had to mention it in the Quran. He had a lot of money. People thought when he dies, perhaps his money will help him. Allah says his money and whatever he earned as a result of what he did will not help him. It won't help him at all. So this goes to show, today those who were wealthy at that time, they are mentioned, yes, but they are mentioned in a negative way, a bad way. They are mentioned in a bad way. When we talk of Abu Lahab, Abu Jahl and those others, we don't ever say radiallahu anhu astaghfirullah, because they are not. Some people actually say, may Allah's curse be on them. They wouldn't be wrong to say that. Allah says, tabbat yada abi lahabin wa tabba. Allah has cursed Abu Lahab himself in the Quran. Then there were those who surrendered, as I said. May Allah make us from among those who surrender so that we can actually be companions of the Prophet ﷺ in the hereafter. When you try and follow his example, you will be resurrected with him. When you love him truly, not just by your tongue. The love is to do with following. Yes, we are human beings. We falter. We make mistakes. But we engage in tawbah. We go back to the path. We go back to the straight path, inshallah. And what will happen? We'll be resurrected with Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. People will wonder how. Well, this man tried his best. This woman tried her best. And that's why, look, today they are resurrected. We were unable to be sahaba, but we can try our best to become so in the hereafter. Al-mar'u ma'a man ahabba. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam says, a man will be with whom he loves in the hereafter. And that love is not the love that we know in this world. It is actually the love of following. You love Allah and His Rasul, and you love the pious, and you love those who are really decent. You will be resurrected with them. Even the friendship we keep in the dunya today, we need to ask ourselves, am I ready to be resurrected with these people? If it is the case, maintain it and work on it as hard as you can. If you would consider it an honor to be resurrected with certain people, befriend them. Because that is what the Prophet ﷺ said. But if you do not want to be resurrected with some, don't befriend them, or make it clear to them that, you know what, this is wrong and that is wrong and this is wrong, etc. There was a third category of people Allah speaks about in the Quran. Those who showed that they were Sahaba, but they were not Sahaba. The likes of Abdullah ibn Ubay ibn Salul and the cronies, the hypocrites. What happened to them? They thought, you know, we're going to lose. But now, we are going to lose if we accept in that those who are disbelievers will stop dealing with us. And if we reject it, then those who are believers may stop dealing with us. So the best thing to do is to sit on the fence. We will say we are believers, but when we go back to those people, say, listen, we are not really believers. We are just playing the fool. وَإِذَا لَقُوا الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا قَالُوا آمَنَّا وَإِذَا خَلَوْا إِلَى شَيَاطِينِهِمْ قَالُوا إِنَّا مَعَكُمْ. When they are with the believers, they say, we are with you. But when they go back to their shayateen, to the disbelievers, they say, don't worry, we are with you. So who are you with? No one. Subhanallah. Allah says, those are the hypocrites. إِنَّ الْمُنَافِقِينَ فِي الدَّرْكِ الْأَسْفَلِ مِنَ النَّارِ. The hypocrites, they are neither the kuffar, nor are they sahaba. They are the worst. They will have the worst punishment in hellfire. They didn't even have the courage to stand up for what was right. Subhanallah. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grant us a lesson. So my beloved brothers, let's understand one thing very clear. Yes, we do go through the lives of the Sahaba radiallahu anhum, but we need to know why we do that. What is so important about them? Not just that, oh, these were companions of Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, so it's okay. Who was Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam? He was the one who endured because of us. Wallahi, we are sitting here today because he endured. He struggled, he strove. The instruction of Allah was fulfilled and the companions were chosen by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to surrender to the hukum and the command of Allah at any given time. Whenever it came, midnight it came, they went. On one occasion, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, after a certain war, a certain battle, he instructed his companions, because Jibreel alayhi salatu wasalam came to him telling him, you have put your weapons down, but the angels have not yet put their weapons down. Immediately he says, لا يصلين أحدكم العصر إلا في بني قريظة. None of you should read Salatul Asr until you get to Banu قريظة. Wallahi, it is reported that the Sahaba radiallahu anhum, they did not ask him another question. They just went straight to Banu قريظة. I think if it was in our time, we would say, but why? Just, I don't mind going, but explain to me why. I just need to know what's the story here. By that question, that is why we are not Sahaba. I hope we get the point. That is why we are not Sahaba. People say, well, you know, interest is haram, but you know, it's a little bit tricky, you know. It's a little bit tough. Well, if Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam was here, would you tell him the same thing? That it's tricky and it's tough? Well, that's why we're not Sahaba. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala forgive us. May He make it easy for us. We are going through tough times, but don't give up your deen. Don't give up your values, your Islamic morals, your teachings of Islam, the basics, the principles of Islam. Don't give them up. Because I tell you, if we give them up, we will gain in the dunya, but we have lost the whole of the akhirah. And even that gain in the dunya will be without barakah. The examples I've given you, people who had a lot of wealth, it did not help them. Look at Qarun, look at Fir'aun. They had so much of wealth. Did it help them? Allah says, their wealth did not help them. The number of children they had did not help them. Their deeds helped them. My beloved brothers, this is why we go through the lives of the companions. And this is why every one of us should strive to become a companion of Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam in the akhirah. Let's give up our bad ways and habits, myself included. And let's all turn to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Inshallah, in this way, when we hear the stories of the companions, we'll be motivated, we'll be listening, we'll be wanting to, we'll be appreciative, we'll be making dua for them. May Allah grant them Jannatul Firdaus. And similarly, we would understand why we should appreciate those who have worked hard to get us where we are today in terms of religion. I'm going to end on that note. I want to repeat it once again. This is why, if we understand what the companions are all about and who exactly they were, and why it is that we are instructed to say, may Allah be pleased with them, if we understand that correctly, we will be able to appreciate the entire chain of people. Those who taught us Quran, those who worked hard on us, those who motivated us to do good, those who are good company, those who have taught us the deen, those whom Allah has chosen to help change our lives after we were in the darkness. When we appreciate that truly, we would really be from among those whose hearts are clean and good. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala cleanse us all, and may He grant us Jannatul Firdaus. Aqulu qawli hadha wa sallallahu wa sallama wa baraka ala nabiyyina Muhammad walhamdulillahi rabbil alameen.